Prothrombin time?
That's probably what it was.
Prothrombin time? Okay, so we're back, and I've taken the liberty of putting some values on the board. Now, you have these in your handout, maybe not so much the arterial blood gases, which I'm not going to have you memorize, okay? It's not necessary. But there are certain values in here that I want you to pay close attention to. Okay, now last week we mentioned the glomerular filtrate rate, the GFR, right? And what did we say? We said the GFR in normal functioning kidneys is greater than 60, right?
Yep.
60 is actually, the units are in poise. It's similar to Bernoulli's theorem of volumetric flow rate as to how the flow in the kidneys are affected. It has to do with the diameter of the tubules. It has to do with the rate of flow. It has to do with how fast it goes from point A to point B. Mm-hmm. So the GFR should be greater than 60 in normal healthy people. When the GFR, we said, is less than 60, you know, in the 50s, somewhere in the 50s, the patient's in what? Chronic renal failure, right? And we also said that a GFR that is less than 15 is acute renal failure. So chronic renal failure, acute renal failure, meaning that they may be looking at going into dialysis very shortly. I'd like you to pay attention to our electrolytes here. This is kind of important because when we talk about renal diets and we start to look at how these electrolyte imbalances due to either dilutional situations or through dehydration, hypovolemia versus hypervolemia, the electrolytes are going to come into play. And there's a very specific, signs and symptoms of people suffering from electrolyte imbalances. A lot of times it's, if they're on a cardiac monitor, you can see it, especially with calcium. Calcium is a very important cation in healthy cardiac tissue and perfusion. So when calcium becomes out of balance, either through hypercalcemia or hypocalcemia, the heart is affected directly. So let's take a look at sodium. I've taken the liberty also of identifying what each of these analytes' names are. Eventually, I won't do that. You'll have to know what these are if I write them on the board. So tonight, you're lucky. I wrote them on the board. So after tonight, I won't be writing them. And you'll have to know what these are that I'm referring to. So sodium, the typical value is 135 to 145 milligrams per deciliter for a balanced sodium, which is salt. Our potassium is between 3.5 and 5.5 milligrams per deciliter. Chloride's about 98 to 103 milligrams per deciliter. And depending on the hospital and depending on certain literatures, these may be off by one or two points. But typically, I think we're ballparking it. CO2, carbon dioxide, 20 to 30. Calcium, 9 to 11 milligrams per deciliter. We know our GFR. Now, this is important. The body's pH. The body's pH is maintained. Our homeostasis, or the functioning of the human, where everything's functioning normally, our pH, or protonated hydrogens, have to be between 7.35 and 7.45 on a pH scale, right? Like 1 to 14, logarithmic scale. Now, the body is able to function, and this is basically a wide range. It's kind of called a buffer range, because if we had to calculate the amount of energy of any type of cellular reaction without the mediation of enzymes, we would burn up. We would be little cinders on the ground. Enzymes, which of course we go back to the nucleolus of the cell, and RNA, right? RNA, messenger RNA, RNA transcriptase. Enzymes are made from our genetic coding, and these enzymes are wonderful little amino acids. They're long chains. and they actually mediate or lower the activation energy of cellular reactions so that it keeps us from burning up, keeps the heat down, and it keeps us in the buffer range of 7.35 to 7.45. Now, if we're going up past the 7, if the 7.45 went to 7.46, 7.47, I mean, on the pH scale, 7's right in the middle, right? You hear it advertised, oh, it's alkaline, it's balanced, it's pH balanced. Mm-hmm. Well, the body's pH balance as well. And when we talk about when the pH starts to go up, we're becoming alkalotic, more alkaline. If the pH starts to go down, we're becoming more acidic. And typically, someone can go into acidosis when they don't get enough oxygen, okay? When their blood flow starts to decrease. When someone has a heart attack, or not a heart attack, cardiac arrest, and their heart has stopped. All right, we want to make, these people become very acidotic very quickly because blood has stopped what flowing through their veins. The heart's no longer pumping. There's no more oxygen. They're not breathing. So that's why CPR, you know, helps the patient actually, we create the circulation through compressions. So pH is really important, and it's going to become an important topic for discussion as we start to learn more about assessing our dialysis patient and looking at their labs, which you'll also be privy to as a hemodialysis technician. Very important now, BUN creatinine ratio. This is where it's at with regards to how the kidneys are functioning. Now, in a normal functioning kidney, we're usually looking at 10 to 1 or 20 to 1 with a BUN creatinine ratio. BUN is resorbed through the kidneys in a healthy functioning nephron, right? That was one of the questions, right? The nephron was the answer to that question. Did you all get that question?
Yeah.
What is the main functioning unit? Good job.
That
was for me. I'm proud of you. Good for that. Good for all of you. So, when people are very dehydrated, and you all probably know what it's like to be dehydrated, right? Your mouth gets dry, you get tired, your heart beats fast, your blood pressure drops, you just have all these symptoms of dehydration, you're actually dehydrating your kidneys as well. And what's happening as you start to dehydrate and you don't have enough fluid volume flowing through your body, your BUN creatinine ratio can go up. Because there's a discrepancy in the flow of through the nephrons. There's just not enough fluid to circulate. So if you take a look at some of these values, these are normal values. BUN is 7 to 20 milligrams per deciliter. Urea, 20 to 40. Now, urea and BUN, urea is used mostly in Europe, but we use the BUN title for blood urea nitrogen. Creatinine is 0.7 to 1.2 milligrams per deciliter. And then, of course, you have your arterial blood gases, CO2 measured in millimeters of mercury, and pressure of O2 is as well. And also, O2 is measured in percentages, but be that as it may, bicarb is an ion that actually works to drop acidity in the body. It's actually made by the kidneys. So if your body starts to become too acidotic, then we need bicarb. And we'll give bicarb if someone's had a cardiac arrest, because we know that they're becoming very acidic, so we're going to have to bring them back, their pH back. So bicarb kind of balances an acidic situation. We try to get it to balance acidic situation in emergencies. But we're going to find that there are many emergencies that befall the dialysis patient, which shouldn't if they've got good hemodialysis technicians on site. Okay? So what we're going to do is, once you've written these down, I'm going to try to put this together for you in actual scenarios of dialysis patients. And we're going to try to look at it, so this way you've got a better idea of how each of these analytes participate in the functioning or in maintaining homeostasis of the dialysis patient. So take a look at what we have next. Okay, this is also going to help you with your phlebotomy on Thursdays, because Miss Melanie is going to ask you about electrolytes, and you're going to see that you have electrolytes on some of your homework. A lot of test questions that ask about electrolytes. Okay, so let's look at, we went over vital signs last week too, didn't we? Mm-hmm. I didn't have you do vital signs, but we went over the norms, right?
Right,
okay. Highs and lows, etc. Okay, so let's take a look at two critical conditions of the dialysis patient. Which we're going to simplify. There are more than two, but we're going to simplify this into hypovolemia and hypervolemia. Okay? So let's say you have a dialysis patient who comes in and you assess their vital signs. Normally, after 72 hours, they haven't been able to release any of that fluid. What would you expect their blood pressure to be?
High,
right? Because their fluid's not going anywhere. All that pressure is building up in their veins and arteries. Yes, ma'am.
Is that critical condition of the dialysis
patient? Patient. PT is abbreviation for patient. And I'm probably going to have to test you guys on medical terminology and abbreviations, and I do have a test for that. So I will be handing that out probably next tonight for an assignment, take-home assignment next week. Okay, homework assignment. Mm-hmm.
Well,
yes,
basic or advanced.
I'm sorry.
Is this
advanced
or basic?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know the difference between basic or advanced medical terminology.
I'm saying like the queen, is it going to be like the basic, like the smaller zone?
No, you're going to have a take-home homework assignment for medical terminology. And the quiz I'm going to give you on the board next week, I'll go over before we go home tonight, okay? It'll be one of those on-the-board questions. Okay, so hypovolemia. If we take a look at hypovolemia, this is a drop or a general decrease in what?
Blood pressure.
Blood pressure, right? Now, careful. A drop or a general decrease, which means you need to recognize what we call trending. You have to put your critical thinking caps on. Trending, everybody. What does trend mean? Give me a definition of a trend. Somebody, trend.
Ongoing.
Sorry?
Ongoing.
Ongoing, yes. So trending, someone can trend upward or downward, right? Either way, it can be bad. So you have to pay attention to this. This is why you have to consistently assess your dialysis patient. So let's say they came in, okay, with a BP of, say, 154 over 98, which isn't unusual for a returning dialysis patient, pre-dialysis. They've got a lot of fluid weight, 3 or 4 pounds. They're, too much volume circulating is going to cause their blood pressure to go up. After an hour of being on dialysis, you would expect their blood pressure to drop slightly. So let's say after 1 hour, P with a line over it is after. After 1 hour, let's say their blood pressure drops to 141 over 85. Not bad. Well, top number is just a tad high, but still normal. Now, in 15 minutes, so after 15 minutes, it drops to 138 over 80. Another 15 minutes, it drops to 125 over 75. Another 15 minutes, it drops to 115 over 69. What do you see happening here?
We're losing that person.
It's trending what?
Downward.
I mean, technically, this is still normal, isn't it? It's still normal. But what's happening? It's dropping.
It's quickly.
And within a half hour, well, let's see, about an hour, a half, 45 minutes? Yeah? It's dropped a lot, hasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But it's still normal. Worry, yes? Worry, no?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, I like it. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Worry. Be a worrier. Your patients will do better if you worry about them. Okay? Because this patient's trending downward, that means what? How long are they on dialysis doing? They're there for 5 hours, but typically we go on a 4 hour, on a 3 hour cycle. That's for our particular calculations next week when we start going over what to dry weight calculations. Yes, there's Matt, sorry. We're gonna use a 3 hour cycle. This has been an hour and 45 minutes, right? So they're what, an hour and 45? They're not too far from being done. About an hour and 15. Yes, worry. Because along with this drop in blood pressure, there's going to be other accompanying signs and symptoms. Okay, so what are the signs and symptoms of beginning hypovolemic shock for the dialysis patient? Well, let's take a look. I'm going to go ahead and erase these so I can write down the signs and symptoms now that you understand what trending is and how it's important for you now to critically think.
Lethargic.
Okay, good. Signs and symptoms of hypovolemia. Very good, Sandra. Lethargic. What does lethargic mean, guys?
Tired.
Aw, man, I'm just so tired. Did you know the first sign, the very first sign that you're going to catch from someone who's going into hypovolemia very quickly is they start to complain of stomach cramps. Stomach cramps. Oh, I'm getting cramps in my stomach. You're going to get stomach cramps. And then they're going to get cold. They're going to be cold and shivering. Cold and shivering, stomach cramps. Oh, stomach cramps, cold, shivering. Hypovolemia. Got to assess this patient right now.
Mm-hmm.
We're taking up too much fluid. Yes.
How about dizziness?
Okay, yeah. Dizziness, yep. They're going to become dizzy. Okay, I like it. Dizzy? What else? Okay, dizzy? Yes. Shanti.
Dehydrated.
Okay, dehydrated. Yeah, they're going to be losing fluid. Signs and symptoms of dehydration. Vital sign wise. Yes. Our blood pressure is dropping. What's our heart doing? Fast or slow?
Palpitating.
It's palpitating. It's going faster, right? So we've got a discrepancy in what? In vital signs. So our BP is dropping. Simultaneously, our heart rate is increasing. Our respiration rate decreasing or increasing?
It's increasing.
It's increasing.
Oh, yeah.
Respiration rate going up. Okay? They're cold. Temperature, it may fluctuate, depends. Probably going down because it's not hypovolemia due to being too warm, hyperthermia. It's not due to hyperthermia. It's hypovolemia due to hypovolemia, right? We're just taking out too much fluid too fast. So the rest, why does the BP is going down? Because why? There's just not enough what? In the body.
Fluid.
There's not enough fluid. The heart rate's going up. What's the heart trying to do for you?
What's there?
Feel, the heart thinks that if it pumps faster, it's going to what? Bring up the blood pressure, right? So if the heart pumps faster, what's your respiration going to do?
Increase.
It's going to increase. See what I'm saying? So we've got lethargic, stomach cramps, cold and shivering, dizzy, decrease in blood pressure, increase in heart rate, increase in respiration rate, 6. Work with me on the dizziness. Okay, lightheaded. Okay, what about alert and oriented?
Disoriented.
Okay, all right, Valerie, good. That's where I'm going with this. Okay, all of you should know, alert and oriented, A&O, times 3, means they can answer 3 out of 3 questions, right? Name, where are you, what's your name, how old are you, where are you, what's your date of birth. A and O times two means they can only answer what?
Two.
Two out of the three. A and O times one means they can only answer what?
One.
One out of the three, and A and O times
zero.
No, they can't answer any of your questions. Would you expect a decrease in their mental status?
Yeah.
Obviously, right? So it's not surprising if they're coming in and they're talking to you about the poker game they went to or the casino or who they saw at a concert, and then, you know, an hour and 15 minutes later, who are you? Why am I here? Where am I?
Right.
So they could faint from this too. Right?
Yes, and they can become unconscious.
So then another symptom could be like seeing spots, because I know before when I fainted, like I always see spots before I faint.
And that may be. You may ask them that question after we bring them back, seeing spots. But a decrease in mental status. And we have a decrease in mental status because of the decrease in circulation to the brain. And if the brain doesn't have enough oxygen, we're not functioning, right?
Right. That's true.
Typically, there's 21% O2 that we breathe in our air. If that drops below 21, whether you realize it or not, you're going to feel the effects of O2 being compromised. Yes?
So at that moment, what do we do?
Really good question. How do we circumvent this from them having to be taken to ER or dying? Because they can die once they get into hypovolemic shock, which is one of the reasons we always have an IV bag of 0.9 normal saline attached to the dialysis machine so we can help rehydrate them. So there's a couple of things that we can do, folks. So how are we, let's erase hypervolemia for a minute, and let's look how to correct this scenario. Well, first of all, we need to give them fluids, right? So we need to administer fluids, which is going to be an isotonic solution, isotonic IV of 0.9 normal saline. Going to rehydrate them. Now the other thing is, if they're capable of sipping something, we might be able to ask them to sip something as well. The other thing is, we need to get their blood pressure up. We need to get more fluid to the heart and to the brain. So we may put them in what we call the reverse. You know what I'm going to say about this, my Sinas? Right? What is this? Reverse what? Trendelberg. Reverse Trendelberg position, right? Where the feet go up, the head goes back to kind of stabilize them.
Reverse what? Trendelberg.
Trendelberg.
It's like a German man's name.
If you're laying in bed like this, and this is the head and this is the foot, if we tip them up slightly this way, we can get more blood flow to the heart and to the brain, which we definitely need.
What did that say before Trendelberg?
Reverse Trendelberg. So we're going to do that. We're going to correct this. We may be able to give them some OJ with sugar. Because what happens when the blood pressure drops and we don't have enough fluid, the blood sugar drops in the body. Okay. And one of the values I didn't put on the board, I probably should have, is what a normal blood sugar level is. So normal blood sugar, new values 70 to 110 milligrams per deciliter, used to be 120, and they just keep narrowing the window because tight glycemic control helps the hemoglobin A1C. So if the blood sugar drops below 70, which normally happens when someone bottoms out with their blood pressure, a little bit of honey and orange juice with sugar helps bring them back. Because the brain uses 100% glucose. Did you know that?
Do they do cookies? I don't know what to do when it drops and then I just get dizzy. I don't know what to do. I just lay down.
Lay down is good, but elevate your feet.
Okay.
Drink some orange juice with honey and sugar.
Okay.
elevate your feet and just rest. You'll be good. You know, hydrate yourself. But yeah, the blood sugar drops too. So in all of this, what else is happening? They're becoming hypoglycemic. They're becoming hypoglycemic as well. This is a whole nother medical emergency once we get into those people that are diabetics. And then they go into a diabetic reaction while they're on dialysis. So you guys are going to have to be experts in diabetes. So we need to correct this. Obviously the dialysis nurse is going to be on hand. She's going to help you correct this. You're not working on your own. There's always a dialysis nurse in the center. But you will probably be the first person to recognize that this patient is deteriorating into hypovolemic shock. They're trending downward. Yeah? So we have to recognize that. Use our critical, put our critical thinking caps on. So we're going to do this. We're going to administer fluids. We may even do neuro checks to make sure that if we can correct this, the neuro checks come back. And I'll show you neuro checks when we start performing the actual physical assessment, okay? Going through our assessment sheets. I got some nice, fun equipment we can play with, okay? Neuro checks. So we're going to do this. We're going to take a, we're going to take their vitals. We're going to check their vitals, which their blood pressure is being checked. We're going to check their blood sugar. We're going to do a set of neuro checks. In the meantime, we're going to assess them for hypovolemia and try to bring them back before they can, before they lose consciousness. And a good dialysis technician will be able to do that. Do you have any questions on hypovolemia and what are the signs and symptoms of? Questions? Delphine, do you? Yes, ma'am.
It was just a question. I know BP is blood pressure, HR is heart rate. What is RR again?
Respiration rate.
Okay.
The breathing. In and out, right? Mm-hmm. One inhalation, one exhalation is equal to one
respiration.
Okay? Very good. So their temperature may drop too. So correcting hypovolemia, not too bad. Not too bad. Just like trying to correct hypoglycemic reaction, mm-hmm. very easy. The easiest in the world. One that's so frequently missed that someone can go into a hypoglycemic coma, once the blood sugar drops below 30, it's really hard to bring it back. Really, really hard. So you need to watch for signs and symptoms of hypoglycemia, which leads me to the next topic, which coincides with this, is how to treat hypoglycemia before we get to hypervolemia, okay? Since you're going to see the two together in a lot of cases, you're going to see the hypoglycemic reaction along with hypovolemia, okay? Now, why are they becoming hypovolemic in dialysis? What's the main reason? What's happening to the calculations that the dialysis technician made? Oh, we're going to take off,
too much fluid.
2.5 liters of fluid. Yes, exactly. Too many. We're taking too much fluid off, right? And a lot of that, I said, going back to the beginning of lecture, is due to a improper calculation of
dry weight,
right? Dry weight. They're using their dry weight from 3 weeks ago or 3 months ago. Does that make any sense at all?
No.
Absolutely, positively not. Okay, so let's take a look. While we're correcting hypovolemia, how do we correct hypoglycemia? So hypoglycemia or hypoglycemic shock, we want to prevent that. We definitely want to prevent the shock. Who's ever had hypoglycemic reaction? And low blood sugar. Okay, a couple of you guys. Okay, so when a diabetic becomes hypoglycemic and their blood sugar just starts to take a drop, okay, way below normal, they sweat out of their pores like they walked out of a shower. I'm not kidding. If you walk into a shower and you walk out of a shower, you're soaking wet, that's exactly what someone in a hypoglycemic reaction is, if they're diabetic. So they have, the signs and symptoms are profuse diaphoresis. You thought I would just say sweating, right?
No, not you.
Profuse diaphoresis. If they're very diaphoretic, they're what?
Drenched.
They're drenched in sweat. Like you ran a marathon in 100 degrees. And that's how they sweat, okay? So they have profuse diaphoresis or sweating. Alrighty, what else? They can become unconscious. In the worst case scenario, which makes it very hard, you can't get them to drink anything at that point. You have to rub something sweet on their gums. And by the way, it has to be real sugar. It has to be something with real sugar, not something that has sugar substitute in it. That's not going to help. Profuse diaphoresis.
Diaphoresis. Okay.
Diaphoresis, yes. They can become unconscious or they can have a decreased mental status.
So is that a symptom someone that is pre-diabetic will have too?
Yes, they can have that too.
Okay.
They can have that too.
My mom is pre-diabetic and she's like that too.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Jane.
How do they call hypoglycemia diabetes? Isn't diabetes high blood sugar and hypoglycemia low blood sugar?
No, not necessarily. Janie's question was, why do they call diabetes low blood sugar?
Or hypoglycemia low blood, or why do they call hypoglycemia diabetes?
They typically, physicians will look at people that have frequent hypoglycemia as borderline diabetic, but they can't actually diagnose it without a 3-hour glucose test, fasting glucose test, and a hemoglobin A1C. So a lot of times they'll say that gestational diabetes in pregnant women, eventually they'll become diabetic. But typically a diabetic just means that the body either can't produce insulin or the body produces insulin, but the body doesn't like the insulin that the body's producing. So we need insulin helpers like oral hypoglycemic agents, glipizide, metformin, glucagon. Yes. Yes, I'm sorry.
It does go away after you have the baby, right?
It does. In many cases, yes. Gestational diabetes will disappear. But research has said that if women are frequently gestational diabetic, that they will develop type 2 diabetes down the road. Not necessarily. Don't let it scare you. Just watch your diet. Sorry?
Repeat that again.
So, frequent gestational diabetics that are mothers that are pregnant that become diabetic, let's say it happens on one or more pregnancies, are more prone to becoming type 2 diabetics down the road as they get older.
Okay.
Now, a type 2 diabetic is just a person that their pancreas can still manufacture insulin, but the body doesn't utilize it to its capacity. So there are different medications that can help utilize the insulin that the body does produce, like glipizide. And there's medications that help the pancreas to produce more. So a type 2 diabetic underutilizes the insulin that they have. Doesn't necessarily mean their beta cells are all dead, but that could be their beta cells could be on the way out as well. Because the beta cells are the responsible cells to produce the insulin on the islets of Langerhans and the pancreas. Whereas your full-blown diabetics that have no more beta cells, that have to take an exogenous source of insulin, where they have to give themselves insulin, right? They don't have any insulin. So these are the people who can be really low and get real bad hypoglycemic reactions, or really high, really become very hyperglycemic with blood sugars in the 400 or 500 range. Yes, go.
I kind of have two questions. One is how you can get gestational diabetes. Can you also be like have like gestational like hypoglycemia? Because I know like when I was pregnant, the only time I've ever fake it is like with each of my pregnancies. It happens like 5 times a week. It's like when I got, like, I'm assuming it was just low sugar because I get really dizzy, like, of all the symptoms. And then, like, once I'd be out, my mom would, like, just dump orange juice, like, on my lips and, or, like, give me some.
Okay, so why gestational diabetes? Well, you think about the infant growing.
Right.
And it's using the placenta has to be nourished with the same blood supply that you use. So if you're not eating and you're not drinking properly, and you're not getting the nourishment that you need, you can very easily have a drop in blood sugar. In which case, you know, or especially after you eat, the blood, you know, travels to the placenta, nourishes the baby, maybe travels away from some of your major organs if you're walking and things like that, and you can pass out. That's not unusual. That's not unusual. I think if you go without eating for long periods of time and your diet's not totally balanced and maybe you're not on the prenatal vitamins, that can have a lot to do with it as well.
And then in pregnancy, we've heard you receive dialysis.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. The whole circulation is there, so yeah, they can. They can.
What does that affect the baby or like how that works?
Well, they probably do central line. They probably do a central line, so everything would be circulated, and it would be protecting the baby from the waste products that you're building up in your bloodstream. So actually, the baby's kind of in its own protective space capsule,
right?
Right, and as long as your blood stays clean, the baby's blood stays clean as well. So yeah, it is possible, absolutely possible. Yes, Robert, haven't heard from you in a while. What's
yeah,
up?
Yeah. So when I told you they gave me, like they diagnosed me with acute, you know, renal, blah blah blah. But
yes.
What you think they would have? What kind of dialysis you think they probably would have? Because they was talking about putting me on to try to get the kidneys back going. What kind you think they would have did for me?
Well, obviously you were able to resolve that. Your body was able to resolve it. It was a reaction to whatever the medication that you spoke about, Toradol.
Yeah.
I think if the prognosis looked good, but they just had to intervene for a temporary, they would have done central,
okay.
A central line. They wouldn't have gone to and made a fistula in your arm.
Okay.
Yeah, they would have done central line until they bring you back.
Yeah, I probably wouldn't let them do that anyway. It's fistula. No, I'm just freaking
out. If they would have had to have done it, they would have taken your labs on a regular basis, and they would have seen some improvement, then the doctor he would have done a central line. Yeah, and then they would have closed it.
Ooh.
And you would have been better. And you got better anyway, thank God.
Yeah.
So hypoglycemia, decreased mental status, profuse diaphoresis, they can become unconscious, confused. Easiest to turn around, right? The easiest to turn around, what do? Orange juice, honey, and sugar, as long as they're still conscious enough to drink. You're going to have to hold their head up. You're going to have to tell them, whisper in their ear, tell them to put the, they're going to open their mouth. You're going to literally take the straw and put it in their mouth. And then you're going to put it far enough back where they can compress their tongue against the roof of their mouth and suck on the straw. As soon as they get that honey and sugar and orange juice in, those cups are gone. I have to refill it 2 or 3 times. And then all of a sudden they just come back. And you're probably asking me, how can you give sugar and honey and orange juice to somebody who's a diabetic? Like, my answer to you is, if it brings them back, do it. Because at that point, this is life and death. And once they drop into that level, sometimes it's almost impossible to bring them out.
Yes, that's true.
I've seen people, I didn't see them. I read about people that have tried to commit suicide with insulin. And they wound up putting themselves in a diabetic coma, and they've been in a coma for the last 15 years. They didn't succeed. They just put themselves in a diabetic coma. We can't bring them out. This is why you cannot take hypoglycemia lightly. It's the easiest medical emergency to flip around, but the hardest to bring them back. Yes, I'm sorry, you had a question.
Hope to God so, because
I've heard some scary stories about some of these dialysis clinics that didn't have the necessary supplies on hand. And I'm not going to say which since I'm on video and this is going to be going up, so I don't want to get, I don't want to get, you know. Yes,
as
but
a,
they should have them on hand, absolutely, yes.
As a brittle diabetic, my sister would carry the glucose tablets in her purse.
Yes.
Or candy, any type of candy, anything.
Yes.
But she did go into a coma, and she did, yeah, she didn't come out of the coma. They started speaking about us transferring her. They thought it was going to be long term, obviously, and her organs started shutting down. We lost her on Valentine's Day.
Absolutely.
She was 32.
Okay, and I want to thank you from my heart for sharing that very heartfelt example of what happened to Sandra's family member. But let that be a lesson to all of you not to ignore hypoglycemia and the signs and symptoms thereof. Thank you for sharing that with Sandra.
For normal sailing,
not at all. Normal saline has no, well, on a non-diabetic, in a non-hypoglycemic reaction, if we're looking at hypovolemia, they may not need the sugar once we restabilize their fluid. But if we're looking at a normal saline solution for a hypoglycemic reaction, the answer would be no. But for someone who's in a hyperglycemic reaction, they become completely dehydrated.
Because when I was in high school, that's how I found out I was hypoglycemic, was because I just passed out and I guess I had a seizure during class, and then when I woke up, I was in the hospital.
Okay, you don't remember anything
I don't
in between?
Remember, really.
When you were in the hospital, and they had an IV in your arm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's normal.
Like,
that's standard protocol. They have to have they have to have open access, and you were probably really dehydrated.
Okay.
High school kids do that.
Yeah.
But I'm glad you're okay. Another question. Okay, so basically, when I make my little concoctions of orange juice, sugar, and honey, the straw can stand up in it.
There's that much honey in it, huh?
Yeah, it can stand up in it. Yes, and it works. I mean, it works like a charm. I had one patient, God bless them, you know, they were a young person, they were very brittle diabetic, completely dependent upon insulin and Lantus. And for whatever reason, they went into a very severe hypoglycemic reaction. Thankfully, the aide said, "Nancy, come on, you gotta come see this patient." I took one look at him and I said, "Oh crap, I know what's going on here." It wouldn't, by taking the time out to follow protocol, "Oh, let me go get the glucometer and let me probe," hell no. I went right to the pantry. I said, "Okay, orange juice, honey, sugar, mix it up. I lifted his hand up. My hand was all wet. My shirt was wet when I put it under his head. And I said, "Sir, I'm going to put this straw in your mouth. I just want you to take a little sip." And he took a little sip, barely could take a sip. And as soon as he took that one sip, I'm not kidding, less than a tablespoon, that thing went, and he goes, "I need another." I said, "Coming right up." Felt like a bartender. Okay. I must have given him like 3 or 4. By the time he was done, I told the nurses, I said, "Let's get him cleaned up. Let's wash him up because he's all wet. His bed linens were soaked. His nightgown, you know, the gown that they have on, the hospital gown, was soaked." And within 20 minutes, he was up, sitting in his wheelchair, eating peanut butter crackers. Everything's good. Guess what? Then I took his blood sugar. After like 3 cups of orange juice and honey.
It was not off the charts.
Not at all. It was a 42.
Oh, okay.
It was 42 with 3 cups of sugar.
So it must have been extremely
that
low.
Means we were a hair breadth away from him going into a diabetic coma.
Mm.
Wow.
Yep.
60. Is he diabetic?
16.
Oh, he was 16.
Yes.
I'm sorry, you had to do what?
We have to call the ambulance because he was home and he could not get his sugar up. He was dry.
Yeah, you couldn't get it up, right?
Yes.
We'd have been down too long.
And we need to tell you that he was 16.
16?
Yeah.
Holy crap.
Okay,
yeah, you're right. Thank God you brought him back, right?
Your
thank God, yes. Shavante.
How long do you have, for example, something like that? I'll get what you're saying.
take immediate action, how long does that person have before they go into it?
Minutes. Minutes. We're talking minutes. When I say minutes, we're talking minutes. I bring this up in a lot of my lectures because it was so close, and I just, you know, rely on God that everything worked out right, because we're not having church here, I apologize. It's just that certain things are so beyond our control. Certain things that happen are just so beyond what we can, our minds can, you know, fathom. Things just happen, right? I had a student, young, beautiful girl. She was a brittle diabetic, so she had to take insulin. She was pregnant. She was about 7 months pregnant. And she was in my phlebotomy class, and I was showing them needles and needle gauges and things like that, and I had some new insulin needles, and I was showing them the different gauges of the needles. And she came back from lunch. She says, you know, my blood sugar is like a 270, 263, 270. Can I use one of the insulin needles to draw up my medication so I can give it to myself? And she said, I have to give myself 7 units. I said, yeah, sure. Just show it to me after you draw it up, because that's what we do in nursing. Everybody draws up insulin, shows it to the person who, before they give it to the patient in case they're wrong. Do you know she drew up 70 units of insulin?
What?
And I took one look at the syringe and I just kept going, this is where you should be. It wasn't Lantus. It was regular fast-acting insulin. Had she given herself that, both her and her baby would have died.
Yes.
Do you know, when I did that and then I handed it to her, I had to walk outside and smoke like a half a pack of cigarettes. I'm thinking to myself, okay. All right. And she says, okay, thank you. It's like, oh, yeah, you're welcome. So glad everybody.
So she normally didn't pull around?
Yeah, that's the crazy thing. Her sugar went up. She probably got a little loopy, which happens when their blood sugar gets high. People's blood sugar gets high. It's okay. But she's on both Lantus, which people can take up to 75 units, but typically it's at night when they take it. And they're also on the fast-acting insulin. So it was fast-acting insulin that she was drawing up, because she's told me 7 units, so she goes according to the sliding scale. And I'm thinking to myself, I don't even think she realized till this day, because I didn't say anything about it. I was just like in shock. It's like, oh.
You saved her life.
And, well, you know, that's where I'm talking about, you know, why we are here for a reason, what you know, our Creator has us do. I don't take any credit except just basic nursing skills, which I'm teaching you guys. Basic. This is what saves people's lives. You check things, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, a couple years down the road, she had a baby. Baby's fine. Baby's 3. Baby's happy. Everyone's happy. I'm thinking, so what? You know, she just calls to keep in touch with me every so often. You know, I haven't heard from her in a few years, but you know, everybody's good.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, this is a reaction that you can turn around, but you've got minutes,
right,
if not seconds. Yes. So,
just real quick, the whole disorientation thing and the whole saline solution. Donna, on a regular basis, she would go, she would be taken either to Bayer, it used to be Bayer Hospital, and then it was University of Michigan, to get flushed and get back her system going the right direction, because she was a brittle diabetic. She literally, one minute would be 50, and that next minute would be 500, the next time she checked.
That's hard. And you know, I still can't wrap my mind around how that actually happened. Why the sugar fluctuates in such great amounts.
She was young. I'm not going to say she did everything by the book.
Okay, yeah.
You know, she was young. She still went out with her friends and drank some, and then, you know,
well,
and then got back on track, you know,
right,
things
yeah,
like that.
That will do it.
Yeah.
That will do it.
Yeah.
But keep in mind one very important thing that you should all remember. Your brain uses 100% glucose. It doesn't break it down. Your liver breaks everything down, right? Your liver breaks down glucose, puts it in glycogen stores, and then when it needs sugar, it starts to use the glycogen stores through gluconeogenesis, and boom, we've got sugar in our body. Nice negative feedback loops. You know, our insulin is flowing. Insulin puts the sugar into the blood cells, because everything needs sugar. Your muscles need sugar. Every muscle needs sugar, and your cells need sugar as well. If you've got too much free-floating sugar, you're going to become acidotic. Yes?
I just wanted to add something.
Please. please.
High blood pressure fluctuates too.
It can, absolutely. And it can get higher at night. Many times, people's blood pressure can actually spike at night. Hmm. And we don't even realize it. So this is why I tell people that are hypertensive, watch your kidneys, take your blood pressure medication, and if you ever feel at night that you're getting that pressure in the back of your head,
mm-hmm.
check your blood pressure. Get it out. Get the wrist. The wrists are the easiest. It's hard to wrap those cuffs around your arm by yourself. You know what I'm saying? Just get the wrist blood pressure electronic cuff and check it. You may need something, an extra dosage or a half a dosage at night. You can check with the pharmacist or your physician. But a medical emergency you should always be aware of. When they, in convalescent homes, when nurses aides start their shift, and nurses too, I will say this, nurses as well, they go in, and instead of being diligent and making the rounds and saying, oh, my patient is sleeping, he's okay, no, going in and saying, Mr. Jones, good morning, I'm Nancy, I'm your nurse, Mr. Jones is all wet. He's sweating. When did he have his last insulin shot? If the nurse on the midnight shift gave him his insulin a half an hour to an hour before he had breakfast, Mr. Jones is in a hypoglycemic reaction. And it's a medical emergency. So you can't just look at patients and say, oh, they're sleeping there. Be okay. Be okay. No.
Donna
check on
eat.
Them.
She had to eat before she could every shot. Every shot.
Yes. I would never give my patients insulin until they had the tray in front of them and they were taking the first bite. And I would go into the dining room, if they were in the dining room, and say, come on, do you mind if I give you an insulin shot right here? Because sometimes I don't trust that they're going to eat. And I said, go ahead and take that nice bite of mashed potatoes and meatloaf and
mm-hmm.
swallow that. I said, okay, let's go. You're good. And then we check their blood sugar again in the evening, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you really have to be careful. You may be giving insulin in the dialysis center. I don't know. The nurse may have you draw it up. You may check it with the nurse, but you always have to check with someone else when you draw up anything. Okay? And that's something that I was always grateful that they taught us in nursing school, because that's what saves lives, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, cool. So hypovolemia, hypoglycemia. Any questions? Okie dokie. We are going to, this, you want to take a, let's go ahead and take a, let's take a 15 now, okay? Let's take a 15 if you want to go to, any of the fast foods. Grab yourself something that's cool. What we're going to end up with tonight is I'm going to go over hypervolemia. Okay, we're going to look at that. And then we may talk a little bit about the disease process, okay, of congestive heart failure. Okay, so see you guys in 15.